it's your promises that will remain.
Yeah.
No one loves me like you. All my life I looked a million ways. Now I'm holding to your grace and you.
Thank you.
beautiful spring day. And you know what? We come alive in Jesus. He's the Son of God. He's shining in our hearts. So let's just worship Him.
Buried, you can raise again. good to you today. Hallelujah. We just thank you, Jesus. Oh, you've been so, so good to us. Yeah. See, I am one of many with countless testimonies. We're saved by grace through faith, not on our own. And all along this journey, Lord, you went before me. You were waiting there for me on mercy's road. And so with thankfulness, I bring this simple song. Come on, every voice, we say, thank you, Lord, for your mercy. Thank you, Lord, for your grace.
Every time.
Every time I turn around, you were there to make a way.
Yeah.
Oh,
thank you.
Thank you, Lord, for your kindness. Thank you, Lord, for your love. Every time I turn around, you will see that you're enough.
So we say,
thank you, Lord.
Yeah.
And I will tell the story of my shame turned into glory. Oh, the freedom that I found in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus, for every small thing, every big thing, and everything in between.
Yes.
Every breath in our lungs, every moment that you've set our foot to the ground, we say thank you, God. Yes. Thank you.
By the blood.
could have only been the blood.
Hallelujah. There's this, it happens just kind of subtly, where the things start to crowd out the busyness, the schedule, the achieving, the pushing, the things that we're striving for, even good things. It just starts to crowd out. And the cry of this song is to say, you know what, I'm gonna make room. I've lived my life too long with no margin. It's been too crazy. My affections have been robbed. The cry of the heart is to say, I'm gonna make room. And what that's gonna take is gonna take me surrendering my way, my traditions, my agenda, my stuff, and just say, hey, God, I want you. All of you. And when we do that, the King comes in and he fills us up. And that's why that somebody like, okay, I get it, Pastor, but how? That's why that second song was so powerful, is that I thank you for your grace. I thank you for your kindness. I thank you for your mercy. And this exchange happens in praise and thanksgiving, where we say, all right, I've done it my way long enough. I'm yours, God. And I don't know where you're at this morning, but it happens quick. And we crowd him out. And maybe he's just saying, hey, the cry is to just come back to me. The cry is just to get close to me. The cry is to say, God, you can have all of this. I surrender. And then we get to pick up this beautiful thing of thanksgiving. I thank you for your cross. I thank you for your grace. I thank you for your kindness. So can we do that this morning? Can we just solidify this with some time in prayer? You have both hands up to the Lord, and we just kind of go through this saying, God, I make room for you, and God, I thank you. God, I surrender this stuff to you, and God, I thank you for who you are. Come on. Father, today we thank you. God, we thank you that you are King. We thank you that you are on the throne. We thank you that you are high and exalted and worthy of all praise and glory and honor. So God, just as a sign of repentance, we say we're sorry. We're sorry for making things about us. We're sorry for our agenda. We're sorry when it's just a song that we're singing. God, we ask you to remove that prideful heart inside of us. And Lord, we make the declaration that you can have our heart again. God, soften us again. God, bring us back to the reality of how great you are. And God, we will pick up thanksgiving. We will pick up honor. We will pick up giving you praise and you glory and you space and you room. So God, we thank you for your grace. God, we thank you for your grace that's so freely given. We thank you for your kindness. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you that you would choose to come to this earth and take on flesh and take my sin and shame, for giving me a past, present, and future, saying, God, we are in all of who you are today. So God, draw us back to the central heart, to the central message of your good news, your salvation today. And God, we surrender this stuff. And Lord, I'm believing in this house that through praise and thanksgiving, that the joy of your presence would be restored in our life, that the joy of worshiping you and knowing you would be restored in our life, that the joy of our salvation would be literally restored and renewed and refreshed in us today. God, we thank you for who you are. We love you, Jesus, and we give you praise, we give you glory, and we give you honor. That's so to your name. In your name we pray, amen and amen, amen. Come on, can you give him praise one more time? Amen. 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 Man, has God been good to you today? Oh, what an amazing time of worship and praise. Hey, listen, before you are seated, can you go across the aisle? Can you hug somebody's neck, shake somebody's hand, let them know that you are glad they are here this morning? Thank you. Amen, amen. Well, again, welcome to Faith Church. We are so glad, we are so, so glad that you are here. Man, isn't it exciting to be a part of Faith Church and what God is doing? Man, that was kind of weak. Hey, if you're new here, we just want to say welcome. We've got an amazing team out in the lobby. We'd love to meet you and greet you and hear some of your story and maybe what brought you here to Faith Church. So we'd love to meet you after the service. And we even got a free gift for you. We love to connect with you. And we say this every week, and sometimes it's a broken record, but I just want to tell you, if you haven't gotten involved in Growth Track, you need to get into Growth Track. And Growth Track is your chance to hear about Faith Church, hear about who we are, and bigger than that, hear how you can partner, maybe get off the bench, how you can serve and get involved in on some of our amazing dream teams. So we'd love to have you at that. I will tell you, next Sunday is Easter Sunday, and it's the fifth Sunday. There is no Growth Track next week, but I want to challenge you, April 7th, get in that class, and you will be better for it. And man, it just helps you understand your value as a person and how to get connected. Amen. Our ushers are coming now. They're going to wait on us for our Sunday morning tithes and offering. Man, anybody blessed in the house? God's just been good to you. What an honor and a privilege we get to sow back into his kingdom. He gives us management over all this stuff, and we get to sow back into what God is doing. And why the ushers are coming forward, anybody get a card coming in the door? Wave it at me. You got a card coming in the door? There's only like 7 cards out there. Oh, there they are. They're coming out. They're coming out. All right. Hey, we've given you this as kind of an invite, as kind of a reminder, as kind of some prayer points this week. Here's the crazy thing about next Sunday. It is Easter Sunday. Amen? Easter Sunday is next week. There it is. There it is. Man, we're going to celebrate the resurrection of our King. It is going to be an amazing time. And I need you on that card. There's 3 service times. We're going back to our old times. 3 service times. There's an 8:30, there's a 10, and there's an 11:30. And that card is for you to remind you of that. But that card is also for you to invite somebody. To say, hey, come, sit with me at Easter. Sit with me at service. I will tell you, people around you and in your sphere of influence, they're way more open to the gospel this time of year than any other time. And so it's an opportunity for you to share. And I want to challenge you to say, hey, I'll sit with you. I'll even invite you for Easter dinner. I'll serve you. Come with me to church. And how many believe in we can see hearts and lives change forever for the kingdom of God? Amen? Amen. So those cards are for you. Make sure you take those with you. Father, today I thank you. God, I thank you that you are good. I thank you that you are here. I thank you that your presence is amazing. And Lord, as we celebrate Palm Sunday today, as we're excited about the King literally coming in, God, I thank you that you are here, that you are alive, that you are active. And Lord, we pray over this offering. God, I pray that you'd use it to further your gospel in our city and around the world. We love you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen.
We are believing God for some amazing open doors in 2024.
Good morning, Faith Church. My name is Lisa, and it's so great to have you here today. We're in week 4 of our series, A Psalm in Your Heart. But before your campus pastor comes up, I want to tell you about a few things that are coming up soon that you won't want to miss. Hey, ladies, Abide Women's Conference is just over a month away on April 19th and 20th at our Somerville campus. This conference was created to inspire, equip, and encourage you in your walk with Jesus. Because when we abide with Him, we are transformed into His presence. We're so excited to announce the best-selling author and speaker, the radio host Susie Larson, will be joining us, as well as Sheila Harper, who is the director of Save One Ministries. Early bird pricing ends in March, so if you haven't registered yet, get your tickets at abideconferencesc.org and invite all the ladies in your life. We can't wait to see you. Easter at Faith is just a few weeks away. It's an exciting time for our church as we come together to celebrate and learn about the resurrection of Jesus. Get ready for an impactful message. family-friendly activities, and Easter festivities. Since the service tends to draw a large crowd, many of our campuses have added service times to accommodate everyone. To learn more, head over to faithishere.org/events today. Lastly, March Madness isn't just about college basketball. This month, we're diving into March Missions Madness for Faith Kids. We'll explore the depths of God's heart for missions at home and around the world. The children will dive into the world of real-life missionaries and be introduced to God's calling for all of us to become change makers. During the month of March, the kids will embrace the Boys and Girls Missions Challenge to hear the call of missions and discover their purpose for God's plan to reach the world for Christ.
Hey guys, before we wrap up this week's announcements, I just want to mention a couple of very important things that you need to know. Coming up on Sunday, April 7th, at all of our campuses, we'll be having another amazing water baptism. Also on March 29th, this coming Friday, we'll be having a Good Friday service at 12 p.m. Visit faithishere.org/events to learn more about all these events. I just want to thank you so much for tuning in today. If you're new to Faith, scan the QR code down below. And to catch up on all of our series, visit our YouTube channel or download our Faith mobile app. Now, check out this dope bumper and get ready for your campus pastor.
The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures, and He leads me beside quiet waters. He
Faith. Hey, good to see everybody today. You look awesome and amazing, and what a joy to be back in the house of the Lord and praise and worship Him. We are in the Psalms, doing a series on the Psalms. We started out with Psalm 139, just all about the greatness of God, who He is, some of His attributes, His omniscience, His omnipresence, His omnipotence, and just rejoiced in who He is. A couple weeks ago, we began our series on the Shepherd Psalms. There's three Psalms that are connected together. The first psalm is Psalm 22. It is about the good shepherd who lays down his life for his sheep. And the psalmist prophetically points a picture of what Calvary was all like and what was about. And at the end of that psalm of praise, it says, He has done it. Aren't you thankful He won the victory on Calvary and conquered death for us? And then the second one was last week, was Psalm 23. Pastor Jason brought a powerful message about the great shepherd who leads us, who guides us, who provides for us every single step of the way until He takes us home into His house. Today we're going to look about the chief shepherd who returns in glory. So we'll look at Psalm 24 in just a few moments. But with that, let's stand and look at Luke 19 today. Luke 19, take your Bibles out. It should be on the screens. Luke 19, we'll begin with verse 28. How many know what today is in church history? Palm Sunday. We came to celebrate today. Celebrate the return of the King coming into His city, coming into our lives, coming into our church. And so it is a celebration day today. We're going to read the events that took place there. And we're going to dig deep today. I hope you got your pens and pencils ready to take some outlines and notes and or on your YouVersion app or whatever it is and follow along with us today. But we want to set up with Luke 19 to start with. Verse 28. After Jesus has said this, He went on ahead of them, going up to Jerusalem. As He approached Bethpage and Bethany, at the hill called the Mount of Olives, He sent two of His disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you as you enter it, and you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it, bring it here. If you ask anyone, says to you, 'What are you untying it?' say, 'The Lord needs it.'" Aren't you available for the Lord, whatever He needs? Just whatever He wants, whatever He needs, just say, "The Lord needs it." Those who weren't sent ahead of Him went and found it just as He had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owner asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" They replied, "The Lord needs it." And they brought it to Jesus and threw their cloaks on the colt and put Jesus on it. As he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. And when he came near the place where the road goes down, the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in a loud voice for all the miracles they had seen. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to the disciples, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." "I tell you," he replied, "if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out." Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you for your sweet presence today. We thank you, Lord, that we can come and worship you and glorify you because the King has come. You've come into our lives. You came to give your life for us as a sacrifice, and we thank you for the price you paid that we might know you. Lord, I just pray you'll help me as I open up the Word of God, anoint me as I preach today, and open up hearts to receive what the Spirit would say to his church today. And we'll give you the praise and honor and glory in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Turn to someone and say, I'm not going to let a rock replace me, and then you may be seated. Today's Palm Sunday. What an incredible day. A day when we celebrate the return of our King back into Jerusalem, and we celebrate the return of our King back into our lives, and we thank him and praise him for all he's done because he is our King today. To understand the full significance of what's happening on this Palm Sunday, we've got to go back in time to Ezekiel. Ezekiel's a prophet who has this amazing vision. He records it for us. And so look back there, if you would, for just a moment. Go to Ezekiel chapter 43. Let me set it up for you. Ezekiel chapter 10. Ezekiel prophesies about the glory of God departing and leaving the temple. He has this vision. He sees the Spirit of God rise above the cherubim, go out the gate to the east, and leave the temple area. And he has this glorious vision, and he's also going to talk about the upcoming judgment on Jerusalem. The enemy's going to come in and destroy the city. He's going to talk about their captivity being led into Babylon. He's going to talk about all that goes on because of their sin, because of their idolatry, because of wickedness and evil in the temple. He says the glory of God's leaving. It's going to go out of here. By the time you get to the end of Ezekiel's letter, in chapters 40 to 48, at the end of his vision, he sees the restoration of the temple. He sees the return of God coming back in, his glory coming back into the temple, right? He sees the children of Israel returning from exile and coming back into the city of Jerusalem. All this happens, and he sees it going out the east and coming back in through the Mount of Olives into the eastern gate, and he sees the glory of God returning into his temple. I want to tell you, if the glory of God left the temple of in that day and age, all they had was just a beautiful building. Gorgeous temple, gorgeous building. I would say today, if we don't have the presence of God in our house every time we come together, all we have is a building. Something to look at, and we go through the motions, and we sing the songs, and we do our stuff, but we need God's presence, God's glory, God's power more than anything else we do at Faith Church. I'm so thankful his Spirit and presence are here today. We've already stood. Look, turn in your Bibles. Turn to Ezekiel chapter 43. Ezekiel chapter 43. And let's look at verse number 1. He describes the return of the glory of the Lord. "Then the man brought me to the gate facing east." You see, it went out through the eastern gate in Ezekiel 10. Now he's looking to the eastern gate again. "And I saw the glory of the God of Israel coming from the east. His voice was like the roar of rushing waters. The land was radiant with his glory. The vision I saw was like the vision I had seen when he came to destroy the city, and like the vision I had seen by the Kibar River, and I fell face down. The glory of the Lord entered the temple through the gate facing east. The same way it went out, it was going to come back in prophetically. And when the Spirit lifted me up and brought me into the inner court, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple." Now, he sees the vision of God's glory coming back. This is fulfilled in three different ways in Scripture that we will see. The first is at the incarnation. When Jesus Christ is born, you know the story in Bethlehem. Joseph and Mary take Jesus where? Back into the temple to be dedicated by Simeon. And he dedicates him and he holds that baby up and says, the glory of the Lord has returned. The glory of the Lord is here. And so everything that Ezekiel saw in his vision refers to Jesus Christ coming back because he is the glory. John chapter 1 and verse 14 puts it this way. And the word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. And we have seen the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Jesus Christ was the embodiment of the glory of God, and he is going to come back into his temple again. And so we see that at the incarnation, glorious birth and dedication of Jesus Christ. The second time we see it prophetically is found in what I just read to you on Palm Sunday. What happens here? Jesus starts out where? On the Mount of Olives. He sends the disciples, get a colt, get it ready for us. And he comes down out of the Mount of Olives. They start the processional even before they get inside of the city gates. They're not there yet. And all of a sudden, there's this crowd, this massive crowd around them. They're taking their coats off. They're throwing it at the feet of the donkeys that's going by. They are waving palm branches. They're crying out, Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. And they're welcoming the King of Glory back into the city of Jerusalem. Now, what's the first thing Jesus Christ does when he gets back into the city? He goes straight to the temple. The first place he goes is into the temple, once again fulfilling Ezekiel's prophecy. But this time, the temple is being corrupted once again. The money changers, they're all out in the outer courts, and they're selling all the stuff, and they're ripping the people off, and they're making money and sacrifices. Animals are everywhere. Money's flying everywhere. And what's the first thing Jesus does? He overturns the tables. You see, there is a link between the holiness of God and his glory. God's glory cannot come in when his house is divided. And so it is. Instead of worshiping God, they're worshiping their money and everything else and the ceremony and the systems they had at that time. The third time we see it happen is when the Lord Jesus Christ comes back as our king and he sets up his kingdom here on the earth. Habakkuk saw a day when the glory of the Lord would cover the entire earth. And that day is still yet ahead of us when Jesus Christ comes back. Zechariah prophesies about that day. It says in Zechariah 14 and verse 4, and on that day his feet will stand on where? The Mount of Olives. Where? Outside the eastern gate, up where the Mountain of Olives is. His feet will come down and stand on that mount, east of Jerusalem. And the Mount of Olives will be split from the east to the west, forming a great valley. Verse number 5. Then the Lord, my God, will come, the holy and all his holy ones with him. The good news is we're coming back with him when he returns to rule and reign on the earth. All of his holy ones will come back with him. Verse number 9. And the Lord will be king over the whole earth. And on that day, there will be one Lord, and his name will be the only name. It is not a house divided anymore. There's no more division, no more sin in the temple, no more idolatry going on in the temple. In that day, there will be one Lord, and his name will be the only one. Verse 21, and on that day, there will no longer be a Canaanite in the house of the Lord Almighty. Aren't you excited about the day when Jesus Christ comes back? And every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he is the Lord. There'll be no more Canaanites. There'll be no more sinners around in that day because the glory of the Lord will cover the whole earth. And every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. There will be the separation of the sheep and goats. And the sheep will be with the Lord and all the goats will go. He'll say, depart from me, ye workers of iniquity. I never knew you. In that day, the glory of the Lord returns when Jesus Christ comes back. Mark writes about that day, quoting the words of Jesus Christ in Mark 13, 26. And at that time, people will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds, what? With great power and glory. The glory is returning. The link between holiness and the glory of Almighty God. Now, some things happen when Ezekiel has this vision of God's glory returning in Ezekiel 43. The Bible says two things happen. He heard the voice as of the sound of rushing waters. So like this awesome presence of God, you hear the sound of the rushing waters. And then he says, and I saw the radiant the radiant land full of his glory. What does Ezekiel do? The Bible says, and I fell face down. There's only one response that we can have to the glory of Almighty God, and that's to worship him, and that's to praise him. The word to bow down is literally the word in the Greek language, proskuneo, which means to bow, to worship the Lord or bow before him. And so bow down can also be translated worship. And so the response when this awesome glory of God comes in and Ezekiel sees that in that vision, he falls down on his face and he begins to worship the Lord. He bows down before him. Now I want you to turn to Psalm 24. I want to begin to put the pieces all together for you this morning. Psalm 24 is written by David. The scholars believe that it was written at the time when they are about to take the Ark of the Covenant back up into Jerusalem. What's the Ark of the Covenant represent and symbolize? It represented the glory of God. You had the Ark. Inside it was contained the law and Aaron's rod that budded. It was acacia wood overlaid with gold. Over top of were two cherubim. Their wings did touch, the Bible says. And it was over top of that ark that was said the mercy seat. In fact, it was the judgment seat until the blood was applied. So on the Day of Atonement, the priest would go in, the high priest would go in, one day a year, sprinkle the blood of the bull on top of the Ark of the Covenant. And so you have all this blood spread out on that year. Why was it called the judgment seat? Because the law was contained inside the Ark of the Covenant. It's the law that judges of our sin. What covers that? What removes our sin? It's the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so when they sprinkle the blood on it, it is symbolic of God's mercy and grace, the mercy seat. And they're about to take this ark, and it was said the Shekinah glory of God would come down and rest upon that Ark of the Covenant. It's time now to move the ark from the house of Obed-Edom into Mount Zion or Jerusalem. They tried to move it before. They thought they could move it according to man's way. And so they built a cart and they put the ark on top of the cart and they said, let's take this on in Jerusalem. And they're moving the cart and it starts to hit a rock and it starts to stumble and the ark starts to fall. And what happens? Abihu puts his hand on the ark to steal it from falling over and he is struck dead on the spot. It stops the procession right away. The whole nation mourns because I want to tell you, you can't touch the glory of God with human hands. And he is dead. And so it stays at the house at Obed-Edom. The Bible says wherever the glory was, everything in that house, God blessed and it prospered and God was with that household. Finally, it says, okay, it's time to take the ark back on in Jerusalem. This time he gives them instructions. The glory of God is to be carried on the shoulders of the priest. There is a proper way to enter in the presence of God and we are his royal priesthood today. And so it's in our hearts. We carry the presence and glory of God with us now today. And so they're going to carry that ark all the way up the hill, up to Mount Zion. But he says, I want you, as you go, prepare yourself, prepare the way so you can enter into the temple. Now with that, we'll pick it up. He starts out by telling the children of Israel, the glory of God can't be contained in one small box. And so let's read verses 1 and 2 of Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it, for it was founded upon the seas and established upon the waters. Even though the ark represents the glory of God, God's glory can't be contained to a box or a church or a location whatsoever. And so he says, he reminds them who owns the earth. First of all, we need to worship our great King, who created and made everything, who the earth is his and the fullness thereof. I think sometimes when we come to God in prayer, we have our quiet time, our prayer time, we just kind of rush into his presence and we blurt out all of our needs, and all of our wants and all the things we want God to give us and all the things we want God to do and how we want him to do it and in our time, in our place, in our way, but we fail to realize the earth belongs to God. It's all God's. It's not ours to begin with. We're just tenants living on his planet. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. And instead of asking God more for what I want or what I need or coveting something else, we need to thank God for all of his blessings and all of his provision. And so we come into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Why? Because the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and he's worthy of our worship and praise today. Listen, whether you're the wealthiest land baron and you own acres and acres of property, or you're a homeless person in the woods somewhere just trying to eke out your existence, I will tell you, we are just tenants living here on planet Earth. The earth is the Lord's. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. And I will tell you, God has every right to evict his tenant at any time. You don't believe me, there was a guy that was storing up all kinds of goods. It was you see around Somerville, all these storage units going up. Every time they built an apartment complex, they're gonna build another storage unit somewhere to hold all their junk so we can move our junk from house to house, and we don't have room for it in our apartments, and so we move it to a storage unit that we also rent. And so there was a man in the New Testament that was building storage barns for all of his stuff that he had in Luke chapter 12, verse 20. And God said to him, "You fool, this very night your life will be demanded of you. Earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof." We are tenants on this earth, and he can evict us at any time. Sometimes we focus on our desires and our wants, or all the things that we can't have, instead of worshiping the God who owns it all and has it all already, and praising and glorifying him. One of the things worship will begin to do when you understand this concept of the earth is the Lord's, it pries us away from our covetousness. It takes that spirit that gets inside of us, that heart that gets inside of us of coveting other things and coveting other stuff. It kind of strips us of all that, because we realize that, hey, everything I have is a blessing from God. I worship my Father, the Father of lights, and every good thing come down from above, and every blessing, my family, my life, my health, it is all God's, it all because of God's goodness, it's all because of God's grace. My house, my home, any money, any finances, anything I have is all because of God's mercy and grace. And when I understand that, I know it's all God's to begin with, and it's not really mine. So he owns my kids, he owns my wife, he owns my house, he owns my stuff, he owns everything, he even owns my own life. And as you begin by acknowledging his ownership and his greatness as our great king, all of a sudden there comes alive inside of you this creative work that God has for his children. In fact, he said in verse number 2, look at that, "For he founded it on the seas and established it on the waters." So you see this picture of in creation, God separating the waters from the land, and he establishes the land, he establishes the earth, he establishes a place for us to live and dwell on. So what does he do in our own life? He will establish our foundation on the Lord Jesus Christ, and then he does everything else creatively for us and through us. He's able to create a solid foundation in your life where there had been none before when the King of Glory comes in. So we worship our great King. Second thing, though, in our worship and praise, and this is a great pattern for worship in Psalm 24, we worship our holy King. He's holy. Look at verse number 3. The psalmist asked the question, "Who may ascend to the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place?" A couple of questions. "The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or swear by what is false. They will receive the blessing from the Lord and vindication from God their Savior. Such is the generation who seek him." Now, when we're struck with the awesome greatness of God, the question is, how can I get to God? How is it possible for me to ever ascend the holy hill and get near God in all his glory and greatness and majesty? And so the psalmist asked the question. When we see his greatness, when we feel his greatness, we are comes to grips with our own smallness, right? And our own unworthiness. And our own sinfulness. It's kind of like Isaiah when he had that vision of the Lord high and lifted up and his train filling the temple. What's he do? He says, "I am undone, I am unworthy." And he falls down and he worships the Lord in the temple where the cherubim are flying back and forth saying, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And there's something about God's glory and God's presence that makes us aware that we are sinful and we're separated from him. And so David, speaking of the temple, says, how can we get our priest up to take the Ark of the Covenant back into Mount Zion? And we ourselves, how can we come before him and worship him in his holy temple in the heavenlies? Well, the priests themselves are human. They are sinful. And there's no way they can get up there. So it says, this time when you take the Ark of the Covenant, I want you to take so many paces, so many steps, and I want you to sacrifice an animal. And I want blood to be spilled. And then take a few more steps and sacrifice another animal. And go a little further and sacrifice another animal. And all the way up to Mount Zion, you have this bloody trail of sacrifices they make so they can make it up to Mount Zion, what? With the glory of Almighty God. I want to tell you, the only way we can come into his presence is through the shed blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's what the cross is all about. That's what Calvary's all about. And the writer of Hebrews says, now I have access into his presence, what? By the blood of the Lamb. And so we sacrifice. So you see, the problem is, it says you got to have clean hands, pure heart, got to speak what is true, and you can't be divided. You can't worship idols and God at the same time. Those are the things he tells us that we need to do before we can ascend to his holy hill. The problem is, none of us can do that. The only one who ever did that perfectly was Jesus Christ. He is the only one that had a totally clean hands, never did sin throughout his entire life. He's the one who only had a pure heart. His motives were always right, always pure. He's the only one who spoke what was true, fully true. He's the only one who wasn't divided by a worship to idols, right? So how can we ever do that? I've got to have the blood of Jesus Christ in my life. The amazing thing is when I say, God, I need you, come into my heart, come into my life, he immediately imputes into you his righteousness. So now I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And so through him, because he has made me holy, I can now come into his presence. Now here's what happens. It's his blood, it's his holiness in us that allows us to come into his presence. But he also does something else. The Holy Spirit changes us and begins to transform us. And so all of a sudden, I'm beginning to look and talk and act like Jesus. So all of a sudden now, my hands are holy because I'm not giving them to sin. I'm not entering into every sin I used to do. He's broken that power of sin over me. Now my heart is pure and undivided. Now I'm not having other idols in the way that I used to follow and serve all my life. Now I speak what is truthful and honest. I do not swear by what is false. And the gift of salvation he gives me is righteousness. But then that is worked out in my life by the presence of his Holy Spirit. And all these things allow us, what, to come into his presence. There is a link between the glory of God and the holiness of God. If you are not holy, you will not see his glory. If we want to see his glory, it will make us holy. The two go hand in hand. Psalm 24 then comes to me when I am outside the temple of his presence. I ascend to the hill of God through the work of Christ, coupled with my desire and action to receive his help. I say, God, I can't do this. I need you. The Holy Spirit then seeks to produce that life of Jesus Christ inside of me so that I too can have what? Clean hands, a pure heart, undivided loyalty, and speech without deception. The glory of the Lord is holy, and holiness is required to experience the glory of the Lord. So I worship a holy God. Do we long for his presence? Do we really want to be close? Do we really care? Do we want to get where the Lord is? Do we want to ascend his holy hill? Do we want to spend time with him and worship and praise? God promised Ezekiel in chapter 43 that if Israel would return to him away from their lifeless idols, he would dwell with them forever. And if we'll turn to him, he will help us to come into his presence. If you feel like the glory of the Lord has departed, there may be some in the house today, you say, man, I don't feel and know what you're talking about. That's amazing. I would love that, but I just feel so empty. I feel so dry. I feel like maybe that glory is not there. That fellowship is not there like it used to be. I want to tell you, if you are find yourself in that, it will affect your life. It'll affect your family. And it's even having its effects on our nations as so many have turned away from the Lord. And maybe it starts subtly just by, I don't have to come to church on Sunday. I can just worship at home. I just love them all week long. And why do I need to come to church? Why do I need to be here? And I know I'm speaking to the choir because you're all here. But I will tell you, there's something about the fellowship of the body of Christ. There's something about coming together in his presence, in his temple, and worshiping him and praising him and glorifying the Lord. There's something powerful about that. Maybe it starts by missing our prayer time. Getting alone with God and saying, God, I need you. God, help me. God, I love you. God, you're everything. And worshiping him and praising him. And maybe it's your time in the Word. You haven't opened up this book in a long, long time, and you don't really know what it says or what's in it or what God would have man to do. And so you're not into his Word. You just begin to feel like something's missing. Listen, we know that God is with us by salvation. But we also need to steward the presence of God in our own lives, in our fellowship every day with him. It takes intentionality. It means seek ye first the kingdom of God. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. It means removing any idols or distractions or everything else that gets our eyes off the Lord Jesus Christ, to make space and room for him in our life. We sang that worship course. It's make room for him, make room for him. Let God shake up the ground of our lives, our foundation and everything else. So everything else will go, but only Jesus Christ remains. We got to make room for him. God wants to dwell with us. His glory will not be shared with another. We worship our holy King and our holy God. It wasn't enough for God to return to his temple. We must return to him. And so in his vision, the glory returns, but now we have to ascend up his hill and return to him. But the scene shifts. And in point three, we got to worship our glorious King. Look, if you would, at verse 7. Lift up ye heads, O ye gates, be lifted up, you Ancient of Doors, that the King of Glory may come in. Now I'm going to ask the question, you repeat it after me. Who is the King of Glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. You guys flunked that one bad, I tell you what. I think we have it on the screen. Let's try this one more time. I'll ask the question, you respond with the answer. Okay, let's try it. Who is the King of Glory? Strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, ye gates, lift them up, you Ancient of Doors, that the King of Glory may come in. Who is he, this King of Glory? The Lord Almighty. Hallelujah! Give yourself a hand. You did pretty good there. You did better. The scene shifts in verses 3 to 6, they're standing looking up Mount Zion. They have the Ark of the Covenant. They have the glory of God. It's them who are coming now into the temple. But when you get to verse number 7 through 10, now the priests are in the temple. They are there. And so what's happening is Jesus Christ is wanting, God is wanting back into his temple. And so he says, what you need to do is open up your gates and open up your doors and let the King of Glory come on in. He elicits a response from us. It's one thing for the King of Glory to come in, but we've got to invite him to come into our hearts and into our lives and into every activity we have. He's the one seeking entrance. In the New Testament, the Bible says, now we are the temple of God. He dwells in us the moment we say, Jesus, I need you, come into my heart and come into my life. And the Holy Spirit urges us to open wide the gates and doors of our lives to his presence for fellowship, to spend time with him, to love him, to worship him, to praise him, and invite him to take control of every aspect of our lives. God, you're in charge. You be at the center. We invite his presence to come in. Gates and doors are designed to keep out the unwanted. The Lord seeks entrance into every action, every word, every thought, and every motive. So I ask you a question today. Is there an area of your life where you've posted a sign, not welcome here? We want God to take this room of our life, but we have these closets that we hide all of our sins in and all of our junk in that we hang on to and we go back to again and again and we pull it back out. We section off certain parts of our house. Do not enter here. And he refuses to come in unless we invite him to come in. Revelation 3:20 says, "Here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me." And so this is used a lot for a salvation altar call. He's knocking at your door. Open your door now. And there's certainly application there. But he goes on beyond that. He says that I may come in and eat with you and have fellowship with you and dine with you and you with me. And so we can have this relationship together. It's not I just come down and pray a little prayer, God, I need you to come into my life, and then I go run my own life and do my own thing. If he is the king of glory, then he's also going to be the king of your life. He's the one who calls his shots. If we are to receive him, it must be willingly and with all the honor our Lord and King is due. So who is the king of glory, we ask? The answer comes back, the Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. He's our companion, he's our shepherd that comes along beside of us and he guides us and he protects us and he helps us every step of the way. But he's also a warrior. I want to tell you, Jesus Christ has never lost a battle. He's our undefeated champion every single step of the way. And he will help us to win those battles that we face in our life. Why? Because he's the Lord, strong and mighty in battle. And when you face a challenge and you face an obstacle, oh, let the King of Glory come in and rely upon him to bring you through to victory. What a powerful psalm of worship. You see this worship of our great King who owns all the earth and everything in it, and he's the owner. And then we wonder, how can I ever get up to his holy hill with this awesome, amazing God who owns everything? And then he tells us, with pure hands, clean heart, don't speak what is false, undivided loyalties, don't carry my idols with me. And then he chooses to dwell in a surrendered life, that we open up our gates of our heart, the doors of our heart, and we say, Lord, here I am. Come in. Cleanse every area of your life, my life. Do your work inside of me. Change me, transform me. Renew my mind, do what you would. And so my question is, have you opened all the gates? Have you opened up all the doors to him? I want you to bow your heads and close your eyes, if you would. You may be here today and you have not asked Jesus Christ to come into your heart and come into your life. He's knocking. He's knocking. His Holy Spirit is knocking on your heart right now. In this service today, that pull, that draw that you're feeling right now, it's the Lord. And he says to you, today is the day of salvation. You open up and let me in. If you don't know Jesus Christ, it all starts by saying, God, I need you. I know I can't save myself. Come into my life. If you pray a simple prayer like that, the Lord Jesus Christ will come in and he'll save you today on the spot and give you a gift. He says he calls that gift everlasting life, eternal life. John 3:16. So he gives you that eternal life now because you have eternity inside of you. But that simply means when you pass from this death into the next life, you just go to glory with him. You'll be in glory with the Lord forever and ever. You got to ask him to come in. You got to invite him. He's not going to force himself on anybody. Every head's bowed, every eye closed. If you're here today and say, Pastor Larry, pray for me. I need to give my life to Jesus Christ today. Just slip your hand up right now. Right now, as the Holy Spirit's drawing, as he's speaking to you. Slip your hand up for just a moment. We'll pray for you today. Yes, God bless you. Yes, ma'am, God bless you. You may slip your hands down. There's somebody else. You'd say, pray for me. I'm ready. Ready to invite Jesus to come into my life. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes, God bless you. You slip your hand down. Is there somebody else? You'd say, pray for me. I need Jesus. I need the Lord today. I'm ready to receive him, ready to follow him, ready to commit my life to him. Hallelujah. Just hold your hand up for just a moment. We'll pray for you today. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, God bless you, sir. Thank you so much. Anyone else? Maybe you're here today and you say, Pastor, I got this closet. My closet of pornography. It's my closet of lust. It's my closet of anger. Hanging on to some anger. It's in that closet. I pull it out. It's that closet of unforgiveness. That closet of unwholesome talk. It's that closet. It's that closet of those bad habits that are hurting my testimony, hurting my witness, hurting my fellowship with you. And say, so I just want God to cleanse the temple, cleanse my temple, just like he did when he came in. And first thing he did when he came into Jerusalem, he turned the tables upside down. He cleansed the temple. He wants to cleanse your hearts today, but you got to invite him to do that. How many are here to say, Pastor, there's some things I just need help with, and I just want to raise my hand saying I need God's help and strength, and there's habits and things I'm dealing with, and things I know that aren't right, I'm hanging on to them, and I just want to be whole today, and I need forgiveness. Just slip up your hand right now. Yes, 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 all over. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. Hallelujah. Let's all stand together. Everyone standing. We have an amazing prayer team here at Faith Church. They've already been praying for you before they came this morning, praying for you, and they're ready to pray for you today. If you raised your hand and said, I want Jesus to come into my life and to save me today, I want you to right now, wherever you're at, make your way down to the front with those prayer workers that are coming right now. You just come with them and journey down with them. They'll meet you down here. They'll show you in God's word how you can be saved, how you can know that Jesus is your Lord and Savior and you're on your way to heaven. So come down and one of these guys will pray with you. And we have a Bible and some things we want to give you. And so just make your way down here. If you raised your hand and said, hey, I'm dealing with some stuff in my life. I've got some unconfessed sins. I've got some habits I need deliverance from. I need some victory in my life. They'll pray with you. These are men and women of faith. They'll join their faith with yours. And we're gonna believe God's gonna bring freedom today. Freedom from whatever holds you back from that close, intimate relationship that you long to have with the Lord. So make your way down here right now and let's just begin to pray, church. Lift your hands. Let's begin to worship God. Let's begin to praise him. Picture yourself on that Palm Sunday. Invite the King of Glory to come in. Hallelujah. We praise you, Lord. We bless your mighty name. God, you are good. You are good. You're good. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you that you own the earth, the heavens and the earth. The earth is the Lord. It's yours and the fullness thereof. Every part of our life, every part of our stuff, we dedicate and we give to you for your use. Lord, if the master says he has need of it, God, we say, here it is, God. Use it. Use me, Lord Jesus. I thank you, mighty God. Father, today we come to you in holiness. Lord, we ask you to cleanse us, cleanse our hearts, cleanse our minds, cleanse our hands in the mighty name of Jesus. I thank you, God. May we be undivided in our loyalties, Lord Jesus. May we put you first above everything else we do in this life. I thank you, God. Lord, we give you our best and our all. We worship you today. Hallelujah. And now, Lord, we say, King of Glory, come in. You're enthroned upon the praises of your people. Church, let's begin to praise him. Begin to worship the Lord. Begin to glorify him today. Oh, I thank you, mighty God. I thank you, mighty God. We love you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord, shake up the ground. Shake up the ground in our lives. Shake us, Lord, today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. Come on, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. Aren't you thankful He owns it all? He owns it all. It all belongs to Him. You belong to Him. Isn't that good news? You belong to Him. Can we do this one more time? Father, today, come on, can you thank Him? Father, today we thank You. God, we thank You. You are the King of glory. God, we thank You that You are Alpha, that You are Omega, that You are the beginning and the end. God, we thank You that You own it all. The earth is Yours. We are Yours. This church is Yours. Our family is Yours. God, it's all Yours. So again, we make that declaration. God, we open up the deep caverns of our hearts, the hidden stuff, the deep stuff, the hard stuff. God, we open up the deep stuff in our life. God, again, we surrender that to You this morning, and we declare You Lord. We declare You Lord. God, not us, not our agenda. We declare You Lord. And God, we thank You that as we leave today, we leave full of joy. As we leave today, we leave full of Your grace. As we leave today, we leave excited about the good news of the gospel, that You would come, that You would dwell. We love You, Jesus. In Your name we pray. Amen and amen. Come on, one more time. Can you give the Lord praise today? Hey, come on, can you give it up for Pastor Larry? What an amazing, amazing prophetic word just for the house. Thank you, man. Amazing, amazing word. Hey, a couple of reminders before you go. Easter is three services, right? Three services. If you come at 11, you'll be late, but kind of early. So you want to not come at your normal time. You want to come, you want to pick one of those, either 10 or 11:30. We'd love to have you back next week. We'd love to have you invite a friend. We also have our Good Friday service. It's just going to be a great time. We're going to read some scripture and take some communion. That's this Friday at noon, this Friday at noon. Listen, have a great week in the Lord. We'd love to meet our guests in the back. Youth is back tonight at 6. Have a great week in the Lord. We will see you back on Easter Sunday.
Joy for our morning, giving us joy. Something burning, keeping me alive. Yeah. Telling me to fight until the morning light. Yeah. It won't let me quit, it won't let me stop. Won't let me stop. Oh. It's rebuking the fear, rebuking the worry. Stop worrying. Rebuking the lies and anxiety. I'm holding on to this one thing that helps me believe. No doubt, cause I believe. You give me hope, yeah, you give me. You give me hope. You give me hope, yeah, you give me. No doubt, cause I believe. You give me hope, yeah, you give me. You give me hope. Try to shake my core. But you forgot about one thing that lives in me. Rebuking the fear, rebuking the worry. Rebuking the doubt and anxiety. I'm holding on to this one thing that lives in me. You give me hope, yeah, you give me. No doubt, cause I believe. Won't shake me, won't shake me. I've got hope.